Yes, it's an important class because it kind of comprises the entirety of, you know, where the Moors originally, how they relate to West Africans. How exactly do the Moors relate to West Africans? And we have to start out with the Zaghai people, who are the people I've been posting on Facebook that occupied Gao or Kaukau, and were the, that was the great capital of the Songhai Empire, as well as the, mentioned as the greatest town of the Ghana, the whole Empire of Ghana by Yakubi. Okay, so it actually dates back to at least the 8th century in terms of being mentioned by the, you know, Arabic speaking people that entered Africa. Now, these Zaghai people also, according to the various Arab writers, were the Takruri, people of Takrur, or the Tukulor, as well as the occupants of Jerma and Habesha. So around the, between the 8th century and the 11th century, the Zaghai people, or Zaghai, as they were called, otherwise Songhai, where people spread from Habesha to the Atlantic coast, as well as up to Libya, where the capital or one of the main centers was Jarma or Jarmi. So that's the same place that was known as, you know, Jerma, or the capital of the Garamantes in ancient times. So, let me see, returning to what Isidore of Seville said, I have in the, now you see this, Mansa?
Yes, I do.
So Isidore Seville said that Zeugis is where Great Carthage is. Okay, so that was the emporium of Carthage, Zeugis, or otherwise called Zeugis Regio. And it was actually a province that, you know, was Carthage was part of. Actually, Zeugis itself, or Zeugitania, in ancient Roman times, was actually considered south of Carthage, right directly south of Carthage, which is in Tunis, or excuse me, in Tunisia. So he says, it is true, it is also true Africa, situated between Byzantium and Numidia, joined to the Sicilian Sea on the north, and stretching south to the region of the Gaetuli. So the Gaetuli were south of Carthage as well. And Isidore, of course, lived in the, I think it was the 7th century AD, and was from Iberia. So he's talking about, it's nearby the area of the Gaetulians, who became, of course, the Numidians. Now, Numidia is actually just the same place where Ghadames is, and a lot of these related people, to people related to the Zaghawa or Zaghai, and the Gorain or Tubu Gorain War. That's why the Numidians were also called black by people like Diodorus Siculus. Let's see, it says, it begins in the river Amsiga and ends at the Zeugitani territory. It has Syrtis Minor to the east, which is the Gulf of Sidra, stretching towards Sardinia to the north. Mauritania's Sitifensis is to the west, and the Ethiopian people to the south. Now look what it says. Directly south of that, I'm sorry, directly, the next paragraph says, like it does about the, let's see, anyway, it says, Mauritania is named from the color of its people. Black is Mauros, Mavros in Greek. Just as Gaul is named from its people's whiteness. Mauritania received its name from the color black. Its first province is Mauritania Sitifensis, which has the town Sitifis. Okay, so this is something that was said much earlier too by the Greeks. I think Strabo also said it, that it got its name from its, although its people called themselves black. Either Strabo or somebody else said that the Moors got their name from the color of their skin, which was black. The same thing down here, it says, a couple paragraphs later, Ethiopia is named from the color of its people, whom the sun being so close scorches. So both of these people, the Moors and the Ethiopians, were named for being black. So Mauritania Tijintani, this is all on the same page between, so it's book 14, 5, 8. And between 8 and 14, it talks about the Mauritanian people, the people of Zeugis, that Zeugitanian area, of the Zauge or Zawagha people, also known now as Zaghawa and Zauge. The town Garama was the capital of the Garamantian region. It is this between Cyrene and Egypt. Okay, so that's all we need to know about that. So just because there's an Ethiopia also named with Mauritania and Zeugis doesn't mean that these other people are not black. So Zeugis or Zeugitania were named after its people, which were the Zawagha, or called in Arabic Zawagha and Zaghawa. And the Zaghawa call themselves, or also called Zawagha in Sudan sometimes. They call themselves the Beri or Beria. So all these Zaghai people at various times were sometimes called the Barbaria or Barbara. That's why I mentioned about the Janawa, because the Janawa were actually related to the rulers of Ghana, who were these early Zaghai people. I mentioned that Janawa or Gnawa, as they're now called, or Ignawan, were related to the aristocrats of the original rulers of Ghana. That's what it says in Ibn Zuri here in this book, Corpus of Early Arabic Sources for West African History. Just for
okay. Audience. I got that book pulled up. I'm ready to purchase that soon.
Yeah, that's great. So the whole point of this particular class is that there is nobody living except for me and maybe some German scholars who have acknowledged that the ancient Zeugis or Zeugis and that the Zaghawa were the ancient Zeugitani, the ancient people in that area of Carthage, which included Carthage in at least by the time of Isidore of Seville. Okay. So the connection between that and the later Portuguese author who said that the Zawagha are descendants of the ancient Moroforos and that they had founded Carthage in the year 1286, according to African authors. That is who they are talking about, the Zaghawa. So that would not suggest that the ancient Zaghai people whose later descendants, the Songhai, claimed that they had come from their rulers were descendants of Aaron or Harun and Wakur or Kur, the Levites, were the same people as these Canaanite people. Okay, which is very, very important. Now, I'm just saying this because I'm saying that me, myself, and I, as well as some German scholars, know that there is a connection between the ancient inhabitants of North Africa. There is a direct connection between these ancient inhabitants and people that were once in under the kingship of, or I shouldn't say that, but were kind of vassals of the rulers of Mesopotamia. But now these Zaghai people must have left before people like Nebuchadnezzar, you know, came around. However, they are also the people that call themselves Ghana. Their kings were Ghana, just like in Akkad, the rulers were called Ghana. They are the same people that claim that they were led by Nimrod, or, you know, Nimrod, son of Cush or Canaan, depending on the author, because Cush is in that area of Canaan, which is in Arabia, in the Yemen. And, but, so the main thrust of my class today, like I said, was I wanted to point out that there's some kind of agenda that has been going on since the Orientalist period. And I'm not sure if it's because of the rise of Zionism or just colonialism in general, but they have tried to knock out the knowledge with regards to people like the Zaghawa or the ancestral Songhai people and Soninke people from the history. They have not connected these people with the Zaghawa. Now, let me just show you how they say it. They don't even know that what they're saying, but they have said it, basically, that the ancient Zeugis people and Zeugitania were the ancestors of the Zaghawa. Okay, so here we have Zeugitania Regia, the more northern part of the Roman province of Africa, okay? Pliny seems to be the earliest writer who mentions the name Zeugitania. Okay, so it talks about Zeugis and Zeugitanus by Solius. All these ancient writers talk about Zeugis near Numidia, next to Numidia, in what's called Africa or Tunis, you know, the area of Tunisia and Carthage. Now, here's an encyclopedia, and you can see this this text, right, Mansa?
Yes.
Yeah. So the Encyclopedia of World Muslims says, I should have quote marks because I'm not saying it. It is very probable that this name, Azuagha, they're talking about the Azuagha, is composed of two elements, Zakia, which is merely a variant of the Zakia of the Berber genealogist, and Ar is the second element in the name of an ancient Libyan tribe of Azuagha, identical with the Zawakes of Herodotus and the Zawagha of the Arab historians. So right there, it's telling you that these ancient people, the Zawakes, were the same people as the Zawagha of the Arab historians, otherwise known as Zaghawa. Hmm. Now, here we go again. If you don't believe me, wait. That's the same thing. Another, I think it's, this is part from, it's a commentary on Herodotus' books. It says, the root Zeguensis or Zeugitania may be preserved in the Herodotian Zeugis or Zeugis, which I just mentioned up here. Herodotus called them Zeugites, and, you know, in Roman times, they're the Zeugitani or Zeguensis. It says, Zeguis is where, what Isidore said. So, and here I think was from Wikipedia. Zeugis, a tribe in Western Libya used by Herodotus and Hecataeus, was Zeguensis and Zeugitani, literally, well, I think this might be my part. called Zaghawa. Okay, so, but they have not tried to link. Some of them have said that the Zawagha, you know, they'll talk all about the Zawagha being Berbers. However, they won't even know that the Zawagha and the Zaghawa are the same people. Okay, the Zaghawa occupied Kanem, Kanem-Bornu, Takrur, or the Tukulur area, Gaugau, or Kaugau, Kaugau or Gao, which was the main or principal capital of the Songhai people, and also mentioned as the most important part of the Sudan in Yakubi's time, which is the ninth, you know, much earlier in the ninth century. But the Songhai came much later in the, I think, 15th and 16th century. So here it says in the Sur l'origine et l'emplacement des emporias phéniciennes dans le Zeugis et le Byzantium Afrique septentrionale. Septentrionale. Okay, so they're talking about the Phoenicians in the Zeugis region in this French book. The Zaghawa people, also called Beri or Zaghawa, are a Central African Muslim group of Eastern Chad and Western Sudan. So, but here, this might be a different text source. This is actually a Zaghawa source, I think. But this source is talking about, is linking up the emporium of the Phoenicians in Le Zeugis, which we just said was the Zeugitania of the ancient Romans.
And that's where Carthage is, right?
Yes, that whole area. Yeah. The whole area was connected, Carthage or Art, which is connected to the name of the Gao region later, much later, of Atacartha, the Carthadas, or Hadash, whatever it was called. This name was brought down centuries later by these same people who are called Zawagha by the Portuguese, or Azuagha, Azuagha by the Portuguese, and Zawagha in Moorish Iberia. Wait, what's this about? Oh, so another people that are, you know, closely related to the Zaghawa were the Daju, otherwise called is called today the Gorain people or Daju. And the Gorain are those people, like I said, by the, according to the Arab peoples, came in with Fezan from the Yemen, so from Canaan. Canaan, of course, is, where's Canaan, Mansa?
Canaan is southern Arabia.
Right.
Now, how far up does it go? Does it go up to where Nimrod was up that high?
Well, I'm not sure what you mean when you say Nimrod, but Canaan. Okay. Canaan was the Wadi Kanana area, and getting up to where the Kanana tribe also lived in the Hejaz. That's why, like I say, Mecca, south of Hejaz, was considered by one of the Arabic writers the lowland or plain, low plain of Canaan. You know, this is in medieval times, they're calling it the lowland of the Kanana tribe.
Okay.
Meaning the land of the Canaanites, lowland of the Canaanites. And as I mentioned as well, the Kanana are also found in the Gor area with these people. The Gor area is called the Jordan Valley.
Okay.
Okay, so this is Gor. It's spelled G-H. Now it's spelled G-H-A-W-R. Originally it was G-H-O-R. Called Gor Safi. And this is the area of which was once the ancient Mayan or Minaean people who founded Mayan. And Mayan or Ma'on in the Bible, in Arabic sources, is a son of Lut, or Lot, just like Moab is a son of Lot. That is why they called themselves, or the ancient, the people in the 11th century and before 10th century called themselves the children of Lut and the Moabites. Okay, but the Ma'an only arrived there after the 4th century. So the original Ma'an or Manaeans, also called Ma'an bin Asur in our traditional sources, came from the Yemen and Hadramaut, in fact, originally. They were also called in, they also founded Amman. Amman, remember I said that the Omani tribe, or Az-Oman, were found in the area of Petra, extending eastward, as well as they were found in Yemen next to the Kudat or Kuda tribe in the far south along the near the coast. So these Amman people were a group of Manaeans from the Gabaane tribe. And the Gabaane are known in the Bible as Gibeon or Gibeonites. So that's why I'm saying you have all of the evidence that or implication that these people came from the Yemen rather than the Levant.
Okay, yes.
And the Gibeonites themselves are also called Sheshemites, and the Sheshemites in the Targums are equated with the Sulaim tribes. So all these Sulaim or Salamian peoples of the Dead Sea, where these people are basically descendants of these Manaean people. People who in the archaeologists call Manaeans or Ma'in. Okay, Ma'in. So, but what I wanted to say about these people, see how the color of these people, are living what you know, it's also called, considered part of the Levant. And a lot of the Levant, or at least the southern part of the Levant, was considered the land of Shem. The land of Shem. And what people have not gotten is that Shem was the name of dark brown people that lived in the area between the Yemen. When I'm saying the Yemen, I'm talking about the whole of Southern Arabia, not today's Yemen. Because the Asir, area was considered part of the Yemen, for example. And I have a map I'll show you in a second. But in the 9th century, the Yaqubi, the man that says Gao, was the capital. I think he's the one that said Gao was the capital of Ghana, or of the Sudan, the most powerful, richest city. He says Shem's portion was the center of the earth. And Al-Tabari said that Shem, the area of Shem was between Yemen and Syria. Between the Yemen and Syria. Not Syria, but between the Yemen and Syria. Shem's portion was the center of the earth. That's the center of the earth, between the Yemen and Syria. Ham's portion was what surrounded it, as well as, look, Ham's portion is also the Yemen, Hadramaut, extending to Oman, and the Badrain, which is the Badrani area, and to the Alij, which was between Hadramaut and Yamama, or Yamama, not Yamama. I don't know how you pronounce it.
That's how you said, Yamama.
Yamama, okay. Uh-huh. Yamama.
I heard now that they use that word down in Guinea. So I'm not sure if they're the same people.
Well, that's the name of the, that's a common Muslim name too. For it's like became Jemima in English. Jemima mm-hmm. in English. It's like the Hebrew Canaanite name. So I'm not surprised that it's there. Between that Yamama is southern part of Najd. or Central Arabia, and it's called also Wadi Dawasir, where the, you know, where the giant black people known as Dawasir of the Azd also live. And to the Yabrin, also called Ibrahim. So they lived in Hadramaut and also in, now they live in actually in Africa, and they're discriminated against, as well as Oman. But the area of Oman now is occupied by non-Afroasiatic people. And the Wabar, which is also between Iram and Shahir, which is in, you know, the Hadramaut area, and the, in fact, it was supposed to be in the southern part of the Rub al-Khali, in the sands of Hadramaut. Okay, and the Dana Desert, which is Eastern Arabia. Ham was also granted the Maghrib, and the coastland. He was the ancestor of the Kush, Canaan, the Nubians, the Zanj, and the Ethiopia. Now, some authors use the name Zanj for, you know, later the name Zanj just meant the black people, like, you know, just like Ethiopian or more. But originally, apparently, it's the group of the Az people, and the term was also used for the inhabitants of Mogadishu. So the people that came into Mogadishu, especially people like the Kudman of the Yemen. Now the Kudman, of course, were the Kadmonites of the Torah or Bible. Kadmonites, and also called the people of Kanem, which they've wrongly interpreted as meaning people of the East. So Ethiopia probably has been mistranslated from Abyssinia, I'm not sure. So, but just the reason I brought this up is because when you look at this book, which was published by the University of Ghana, but was also, let's see, first it was published by Marcus Wiener, and now University of Ghana and the Cambridge University Press, part of University of Ghana. So I'm not sure why they took that part out, the part about Ham's area extending, I mean, being Yemen, the Hadramaut, Oman, you know, all these areas in the Dana Desert. Now let me show you where that is, just in case we want people to get confused. And we're not just talking about the southern part of Arabia.
Okay.
At all. Okay, so here is Ghana. Can you see this map, Mansa?
I don't see it yet.
You don't see the map?
No, it's on, still on the, what you got from that book.
Oh. Hold on. Hi, Orthodox Moore. That's Taiwan, right?
Yes, ma'am. How you doing?
Okay, good.
Anyway.
This is long, brother, man.
Okay, now do you see it yet? The map?
Yes, it's there now.
Oh, good. Okay. So, Taiwan, I was just saying how, you know, Yacoubi in the 9th century said that the entirety of this area, Yemen, the area surrounding the northern part of the Najd and southern Levant, south of Syria, was considered Shem. And that the people there actually were called, I didn't get to this part yet, but they were called Abyad. And I had showed a picture of the present inhabitants of Jordan who are still Abyad in color. Now, he said Yemen, he said this area, which is Hadramaut, with where Wabar and Yabrin were, there's people called Yabrin or Yabir in Somalia who are discriminated against. This is the area where Tabari said the Ibir extended from Hadramaut to this area, Mama, as well as the Alij area. Okay, so all this area was the land of Ham, and the Dana Desert, the land of Ham. Okay, so in the Najd to the area of south of Syria is Shem, where the people were of a black buckwheat color. That was the term used for Abyad. And that's why I showed the people of Jordan who are still of that color. Let me share. You guys see this picture of the Jordan
people? Go on the map.
No. Okay. So I don't know why I have to keep new share. Got it? Okay. So here are the people of Gorsafi I was stating, which used to be called Ma'in, okay, because it was founded by the Ma'in, otherwise called Mena'ans in English. And the Mena'ans are, of course, as I said, the Ma'in, who were, in Arabic tradition, children of Lut, just like Moab was a child of Lut, or Lut. Moab and Ma'in, or Ma'on of the Bible, were children of Lut. And that's why they're sometimes mentioned together in the Bible. And this is where the Crusaders invaded. In fact, they had a castle in this town called Karak de Moabites, or something, Moabitarum. So this is the color, which probably even darker than this, which is called Abyad, you know. This is Abyad mixed with red, actually, sometimes. Red meaning the white people, okay, the Persians, and that term Japhet later on came to mean people that were of red color, meaning the European, the Persian or Iranian, the Syrian, people of that sort. But these, the Black Syrians, these are actually mixed people now, but the Black Syrians, people of brown, dark brown color, are the white or Abyad people in Arabic texts and sources. So people need to remember that. Okay, and so I was saying, Tyvon, that, you know, not only did they deliberately wrote the Zaghawa or Zaghai tribes, who became the Songhai of Gao, Kanem, and Takrur, out of North African history, but they neglected to put in what was said about Ham being the people of Yemen, Hadramaut, Oman, Badran, Alij, Yabrin, Wabar, which is where ancient Iran was, or Aram, and the Dana Desert. All the areas surrounding the northern part of the Najd, extending to what's south of Syria. Ham was also granted the Maghreb and the coastlands in general. He was the ancestor of the Kush, Canaan, Nubians, Zand, and Abyssinians. Okay, so. But I was saying that in this book, I have them looking at, they have that same passage of Yacoubi's, but they wrote out that part. And that passage also begins with, when Noah woke up from his sleep and learned what had happened, he cursed Canaan and Ham of his posterity, or the Kipt, the Habasha, and the Hind, who were an Arabian people, which later moved into, or early on moved into India. Canaan was the first of the sons of Noah to convert or revert to the ways of Kabil, and indulged in distractions and singing, and made flutes and drums and guitars and cymbals, and obeyed Satan in vain amusements. Okay, so basically, they're saying, you know, the children of Cain, and meaning the children of Canaan. That's where that actually the root word for Canaan comes from, Cain, or Cani. So Noah divided the earth between his sons, assigning to Sam the middle of the earth. And I, like I said, Tabari claimed Sam or Shem was between the Yemen and Syria. And to Ham, the land of the west and the coast, the posterity of Cush bin Ham, and Cush bin Ham are the Nuba, the Sanj, and the Habesha. Okay, a different translation of Yakubi's work, but they leave out the entirety of the, this three dots, which leave out the whole part about the Dano Desert and all the, the whole of Arabia surrounding the northern Najd. So, but the most important part is, the fact that the Songhai are not connected by modern, a lot of people don't know that the Songhai were the Sughai or Zaghai people who founded this area of Carthage called Zeugis and Zeugitania Regia in the Roman, it was a Roman province of Africa that Carthage was located in. Next to Numidia, and I was just showing how, and I need, I'm glad you're here because I like to go over it because it's hard for people, for people to grasp sometimes all this information, which links directly the Songhai people with the ancient founders of Carthage. So the Songhai people were the Zugai or Zaghai or Zakhai, otherwise known in Arabic as Zawagha and Zaghawa. Okay, and this encyclopedia, relatively recent, says it is very probable that this name is composed, speaking of the people related to the Zawakes of Herodotus, right? It is very probable that this name is composed of two elements, Zakia, which is merely a variant of the Zakia of the Berber genealogists, and Ar, which is the second element recurring in the name of the ancient Libyan tribe of Azuagha, identical with the Zawakes of Herodotus in Tunisia, right? And the Zawagha of the Arabian or Arab historians, okay? So this man is smart enough to pick up that the Zawakes were the wakes of Herodotus and Hecataeus in the 6th century BC were the same people as the Arzukatani and the Zawagha, which is the name even today of the Zaghawa in the Sudan. Zawagha and Zauge are the names of the Zawagha in Libya, Chad, and Sudan. And I was saying, but in medieval times, they had moved southward from Jerma, places like Jerma, into Gao and Takrur and Kanem. So the whole, all these people who are claiming to be Berbers, because the indigenous name for the Zaghawa is also Beri. This is what Zaghawa site says. The Zaghawa people, also called Beri or Zaghawa, are a Central African Muslim group, right? They're not as many in Libya now, of course, because the people were kicking all the black people out that have been there since time immemorial. So the Beri, they're also called Beria, and their language is called Berabir, where the people are called Berabir. So that's why they call the various peoples around the Genoa or Gnawa, who extended between Wargla and Ghana, they call them Barbaria, or Barbaria, or El Berabir. Another thing, so again, the purpose of this particular session was to show how they have literally changed everything to suit their narrative that black people of the Sudan were only slaves of some imaginary white people called Berbers and Arabs, okay? Or Semites. So, for example, Tariq of the Nafsawa, which are, you know, or the black people of modern Libya, he was supposed to be a slave of the Arabs, right? So in this book, Corpus of Early Arabic Sources for West African History, at least the Cambridge University version, it says, when Tariq crossed the sea, he came out at the mountain named after him, Jebel Tariq or Gibraltar, which everybody knows, and sent forth the Sudan to make war. When the Goths saw these frightful forms, they were terrified. The Sudan used to take Gothic and Christian prisoners and slaughter them and show that they were going to eat them. This increased their fear and terror. Now, it doesn't say anything about the Sudan among the Berbers, does it? No. It says, he sent for the Sudan. This is Ishaq bin al-Hussein who wrote this. Let's see. In the 10th century, he wrote it. Now, this, whoever edited this book says, they change it to say, I don't know where it is now, but that Tariq had some Sudan among the conquerors of Iberia. In other words, they're putting words in the mouths of these ancient, you know, or these medieval writers who said that, you know, basically the people that were with Tariq were Sudan, meaning were black people. Okay. How do we know this? Because how do I know it? I don't know if anybody else knows it, but I know for a fact that the majority of people that first went up to Spain with Tariq were Masmuda and Zenata Berbers. Now, what does Ibn Butlan say about in the 11th century about the Masmuda? He says, the color is mostly black, or the Berbers in general. Their color is mostly black, though some pale ones can be found among them. If you can find one whose mother is Gutama, whose father is of the Sanhaja, and whose origin is Masmuda, then you will find her naturally inclined to obedience. Their color is mostly black. That's talking about the Gutama, the Masmuda, and the Sanhaja. How do we know he's not talking about black in terms of dark, or even in terms of my color? Because he says later on, he calls the Beja golden colored, the same writer, the same Greek writer of the 11th century. Greek slave Ibn Butlan of Iraq, because, you know, the Berber women were brought into Iraq and they were black. I'm sorry, I can't help that. Neither can we, nobody can help that. And I've mentioned many times before, and he's not the only one that calls the Masmuda or Masamita Berbers black. In this book, why don't they mention that? They mention Al-Masudi. This is a book, Corpus of Early Arabic Sources for West African History. It talks about Masudi in here. I mean, they have his references to Africa. Why do they skip over what Bernard Lewis, the king of Middle Eastern studies, said about this Abu Shama? It's not Masudi. It's Abu Shama al-Makdisi, who lived in the 14th century. Al-Makdisi is the same as Abu Shama. So Mukadasi. So they have both Mukadasi and Mukadisi in here. But no mention of the fact that Abu Shama says that the Masmuda were black skin. Okay? Ibn Kathir said that the Berbers were black skin. He's a Kurd or Syrian, I'm sorry, Syrian. Nasir Khusraw says that the Masmuda were black skinned. This is written by Yaakov Lev, a specialist on the Fatimid dynasty. Has a couple books out where he says that Nasir Khusraw of Persia or Iran said that the Masmuda were blacks. And here it says, and characterized them as infantry who used lances and swords. They comprised 20,000 of the Fatimid troops. 20,000, just completely ignored. Okay, so if anybody tries to say, oh, he didn't really mean, you know, this guy that said that the Tariq sent forth to Sudan, he wasn't talking about the Berbers. Yes, he was talking about the Masmuda Berbers and the Zenata Berbers. And the probably the most important group of them were the Magrawa, who are called in the south, they're called Magrawat as Sudan, as well as the Jarawa, who are in fact the Garawan people. The Garawan, who otherwise are called Gorain and Wangara or Wagara. And in fact, there's a, book called The Problem of the Judaized Berbers. The Problem of the Judaized Berbers that I went over last week. And I wanted to actually correct a few things I said last week about the Moabites, first of all. That Moahib was plural for Moabite. That's a mistake. I didn't mean that word, Moahib. Muahib were a branch with the children of Lut or Hamida tribe inside the belly. The belly, or just like the Farain bin belly, were also. Now, I also said, and those people were, of course, all closely related people that were of the Kudai tribe or Kudat in Yemen or Hadjamal. That's where I wanted to go. Problem of the Judaized Berber. Let me see if I can look it up. It was on JSTOR. And anyway, I had said last week that the Bakara Negroes mentioned in the 11th century were probably the Bakara, meaning the Bakara Arabs that traveled over from Sudan, which I think that was later. But anyway, here we go. Maybe I can. If anybody doesn't have JSTOR, you should really try to get it because it has, you know, thousands of texts in there that you can't really find elsewhere unless you're in the university.
What was that?
This is called JSTOR. JSTOR, J-S-T-O-R. You have to either join it for $100-something, or I think right now during the COVID they had some access, free access. But anyway, you see where I'm actually, do you see it now, what I'm bringing up?
The first word on that page we're looking at is Zaghai.
Oh, okay, never mind. I keep having to do new share on this. I forget, it's not Google Meet. All right, let's see, where am I? Okay, so this is one of the very important articles. You see it now, the problem of the Judaized Berber.
Yes.
Written by H.Z. Hirschberg, who was pretty, you know, knowledgeable about Jews in Africa. Written 1953. So he found out that the Bakara Negroes are mentioned around the 11th century as Jews, right? Bakara Negroes. But I had thought that he was talking about the Bakara, the Arab tribe called Bakara, which is actually Bakara and Bakara, two different words. So these Bakara were not the Bakara Arabs, but were, according to this book, likely the Wakari, Wakara. The Bakara Negroes and the Wakara Negroes were Jewish. So the Wa and Ba, that's the same, you know, in African, when they say Wa, oops, when they say Wa, they're talking about, you know, a people, Wa or Ba, like Wa Tutsi, Ba Tutsi, Bakara, Wakara. So those are one of the people that were prominent as Jews. And in fact, there's a tribe today of the Soninke, because the Wakara or Wa'n'Gara were the Soninke people. Soninke, again, related to the Nilo-Saharan people that moved southward, known as Jalonk, Marka. These traders, gold miners, they were in charge of the mines of gold, and also considered scholars throughout the Sudan and Ghana. So they came by way of the Western way, and were related to the Janawa, or Janawa, as we call them. So Janawa, of course, are well known. The Gdawa people, okay, normally we think of them as, hold on a second. Okay. Normally we think of them, okay, these are people who are adopting, a lot of Moroccans are getting involved in Janawa or Gnawa music and culture, which is fine, which is good. But the Gnawa are the people who are also originally called Guineans or Gnawa. So they were brought up into Morocco originally as slaves. Let me find a more recent picture. Because the Janawa were the people called Janawa who extended between Ouargla and Ghana, and who were called Barbaria. And they also are called Bambara. Yeah, so originally what happened was, do you see the screen too or no?
Yes, I can see it.
Yeah, the Janawa or Janawa who were spread between Ouargla, according to Ibn Zuri of the 9th century, spread between Ouargla and Ghana, were related to the rulers, ancient rulers of Ghana, but were taken as slaves by the Tuareg of Tamantit, or being taken as slaves as early as the 11th century, and actually I think 10th century, or maybe earlier, by the Tuareg. And so they were brought to Morocco under the Almoravid period, as I said previously. So my favorite, let's see, Gnawa. Everybody actually in their mother are getting involved in the Gnawa culture, and music. Let me see, where are they? I can't even find any black Gnawa anymore. Anyway, that's the root of the word Guinea. As people know, Guinea as well. The Gnawa and the Gnawa were the same word. But anyway, so that's how you got these people up in Morocco. They were natives originally of North Africa, but were also brought up into Morocco during the Almoravid period. And I think it was maybe 3,000 people of them were, for example, killed by the Almoravids when they were, or not the Almoravids, but by the Almohad. So, you know, the Masmuda were against the Almoravids for a while there, and they, you know, a lot of the Gnawa got slaughtered in Morocco. But the reason I brought them up is because these are the people, the Janawa, of course, are the people that Ibn Zuri calls, or was it Al-Zuri, calls Barbaria. These are the Sonic people called Barbaria, right? And like I said, the Barbaria extending to Wargla were the people also descended from Jaina, who's called Jaina, a descendant of Bur, descendant of Canaan. So there is a direct link between Wargla and many of these Sonic people that used to occupy North Africa. So the fact that they spoke, like I said, Nilo-Saharan as a dialect means that they either adopted it from the Nilo-Saharans back, you know, maybe a few thousand years ago, or else that was their original language, which was changed when the Tuareg came in, or some other Chadic-related people came in. Because they had been there according to, like I say, according to the Arab people, their descendants of the Canaanites and the Phoenicians. So, but as the Tuareg themselves are the second wave or second generation described by Ibn Khaldun, who came into North Africa from, well, first from the Yemen, but they lived for ages in the Rif region of Abyssinia. That is what Ibn Khaldun said of the, is it 14th century or 15th century? So, and these people are completely different, you know, even though they also came up long before, you know, before 1,000 years ago, they were in North Africa because we hear of them as the Ifrane. And this text that I tried to bring up about the problem of the so-called problem of the Judaized Berbers states that the tribe of Ephraim in Morocco were the Ephraimites. They were Jewish. I don't know if they were Judaized by the original Berber people that were also there, known as Zenets, because the Zaghawa were also Zenet people, or Zenet people, the horse riding people, and the Tuareg or veiled Berbers were camel riding people. So those are two different groups of people. Tuareg are the people, they had lances, they had camels, they had the lamta or oryx shield called lamt. The Tuareg are known under the same names as Ifrane, living in Niger now. Ifrane. As I mentioned before, the Ifrane bin Bali as well in Arabia were of the tribe of Ephron or Ifrane in the Bible. Okay, so let's see. Here we have the Ifrane. They're not exactly. Now, all these people, the Tuareg in this area, a lot of times were called whites or Abyad people, meaning dark brown people. Okay, so we all know what the Tuareg look like. You guys seeing that, right? Hello?
Yes, I'm seeing that.
Oh, okay.
And my mic off.
So as you see, you know, this is probably the original Tuareg, even though I doubt whether they had straight hair originally. As I mentioned, you know, last year, the Tuareg are those people in North Africa that took the Roman women slaves or concubines, and that Claudian complained about creating hybrids in North Africa. Okay. Gildo the Moor was one of the Tuareg people. Okay. So the Tuareg were definitely one of those people called Moors in early times. Gildo is the name of Tuareg rulers. Galadim or Galadima is the name of Tuareg or the Veiled Berbers, that was the name of their chiefs often. And according to the Arabic text, that name is connected to, Goliath. Goliath. And of course, Tuareg being, many of them over 7 feet, were considered remnants of the Amalekites and Philistines. Ephraim, the tribe of Ephraim, in the Bible, it says their roots were in Amalek. Where were the Amalekites? Everybody should know by now, the Amalekites were a Yemenite people, otherwise called Adites and Yemenites were the same people. That's why the Tuareg also claim to have come from Sawar ibn Ad. So, and they're still wearing, just like other Africans, actually, some other Africans still wear purple, but they especially wear the purple, what I consider to be Phoenician purple, and the language that they write as Tifinag is said to be, in according to this book, or the Arabs, Arabic-speaking writers, that is the language of Daniel, the biblical Daniel. So he lived 7th century BC, supposedly, carried off by Nebuchadnezzar. I wonder what tribe he came from. Anyway, wherever he was taken from, it had to have been the Yemen, because that's where the Israelites not only were, but are. There were never any lost Israelites, except for where people were trying to put themselves in the place of the Israelites. Okay, let me get back to my... All right, so far, any questions? I know I get carried away.
Yep, I don't have any. I'm pretty much in tune with what you're saying. I'm trying to get all the different pronunciations to match up with the same words you're saying. And but I am understanding, that they ended up in the rift.
That's probably 3rd century. That's probably BC that they came northward.
Okay.
Actually, some of the people that very late Egyptians were fought against probably were Tuareg and Fulani people. But the name Ephraim definitely came up, according to Josephus and people like that, with the people from Keturah, all the Midianite people, Amalekite people. Amalekites were actually the ruling people of the Midianites, as I said before, and that's why when Saul said to the Kenites, get from under the Midianites, he's talking about the ruling class, the Kenizzite, Amalekite people. Those are the same people. And the Midianites are also similar, or actually considered Ishmaelites as well.
Who was that? The Ishmaelites.
Well, in the Bible, when Josephus is pulled out of the well, it's said to be by either Midianites or and another section said to be Ishmaelites. So Tyvon, you have any question?
Not right now, I'm just taking notes right now.
Okay. Well, okay, so now I go. Trying to think where I should go then. See, I'll go back to my... Because like I said, the reason I'm trying to straighten up, make certain corrections to what I said last couple of classes, as well as to show that there is some kind of agenda over the last 100 years to completely take away any credit of Africans doing anything in North Africa and Arabia, but mainly, well, I shouldn't call the Arabians Africans because they're the ones that actually named it Africa. But, you know, and that was before Christ that this started coming in the second millennium, apparently, is when the Africans were claiming that Carthage was founded. So we can say a lot of these people, the Zaghai people have been there. The remnant in Yemen came under the rulership of Assyrians. And when I say Assyrians, I'm talking about the ones in Mesopotamia, as well as Nebuchadnezzar. And also the Tuvu Gorain, they seem to have been the Wakur or Wa'n'Gara people because they're also called Kara. And I said, it's interesting that the ancient Greeks are one of them, according to Winters, Clyde Winters. I forget which of the ancient Greeks said that the Garamantes and the Carians were the same people. So it's interesting that the Gara people or Korean people, also called Kara people, called Kara and founders of Garamantes, Zaghawa, as well as Gara Krima and Wargla, places like that. They also have the name Kara, K-A-R-A. They're also called Kara. But the Quran, like I said, they're mentioned in Arabic sources as coming with the Fezzan to North Africa as well. Now, these groups were also in Aden, places like what are now called Aden and the Hadramaut. The name Fezzan is an ancient Southern Arabian tribe, Fezzan. Mosili is an ancient Southern Arabian tribe. You can look it up, see it in Pliny. See those names and other ancient Greek names. So, in other words, evidently these people came very early, but there seems to have been other waves of people or other groups that came, like the Getuls are called Numidians. The earliest Getuls are called Numidians are called by Joseph as Abilates, which is the same area, the people who found the Zela from the Yemen, otherwise called Havila. He calls them actually, it's written Avaloi in, I think, most sources called Avaloi, but that's a known, documented fact that the tribe of Avaloi, otherwise in the Bible called Havila, founded Zuawila or Zela in Somalia. And it's also why Benjamin of Tudela calls Zela or Zawila in Libya, the Havila. He also calls that Havila as well. So these people that called, you know, that lived in Zela, who lived in Numidia, are the same people. They're Getuls, descendants of Cush and Canaan, who were the same people. Cush is son of Canaan, according to Al-Masudi and other Arabic writers. Several Arabic writers consider Cush just another son of Canaan. Like I said, Cush is the name of a large area, or I don't know how large it is, I shouldn't say that. An area of Yemen today called Amran near Sana'a, which is near Marib. Trying to find my.
You have mentioned that, now to me it sounds like they're concealing. And I don't know if that's too strong of a word, but I don't think so. But you say the Orientalists were doing this, or?
No. Okay. Well, the Orientalists, some of them got confused, but for the most part, they were less likely to, you know, they're the ones that said, look, the original Arabs were much darker people than we see today. You know, they're saying that they were possibly related to Dravidian stock, or you know, they were not the same as the eagle-faced Syrian, whatever. That's what, you know, they used the word eagle to describe the nose of the fair-skinned people. Hold on a second. We need to get back to my, okay. This is my thing I had put on academia. And I'm really surprised sometimes going over how everything starts to fit in. So for example, I did not know that there were people called Wakare Negroes in the 11th century. So that's something I just learned, you know, just this week about the, you know, about that it's basically another name for the Wakare or Wa'n'Gara. Here we go, Wakare, Jerma, Wa'n'Gara, Garawan, all those people. Are you guys seeing this actually? The Sami people are sometimes called Jinewa, and they were the founders of Dartichit. But they are the ones that later extend between Ghana and Wargla, and also, of course, occupy Wargla. Like I said, Gara Karima was also a place in Wargla, which is, of course, one of those places in what was known as Numidia, and at least in Leo Africanus's time. So Jinewa or Jinewa came to mean blacks, but was originally connected to Jaina or Chaina. That's why the Wargalan people still claim descent from Jaina or Chaina. And also through Ferain, or Ifrin, Yafrin, the Bani Yafrin, who were with these Jaina people. They were the Zenata people. Just like the Sanhaja were also composed of Tuareg and Garawan people, or Jarawa, who were a huge branch of the Sanhaja people. The Zaghawa, like I said, Zawagha were a part of the Zenata people. The Zaghai, in terms of Zaghai, also is used with the Sidrata people who became Sanhaja. So basically, anytime you're talking about Berbers, you're talking about either Tuareg or these Sakai people, also called Gara people. Most of them, like I said, been pushed southward into the central Libya and into Chad. Okay, so this was the part. So at the time, Songhai still existed. Louis Marmal Carvajal of Granada mentions these Zaghawa or Azuagos, Zawagha, as Moors or Mora Forus. And here's a translation, early translation. There was a noted people called Azuagos who are now, and I hope people are seeing this, what I'm reading, who are now scattered up and down the provinces of Barbary and Numidia. And most of them are shepherds. They live upon mountains and hills and nestles and holes and chinks, like the troglodytes, right? And later on, he, of course, said that they were people who founded Carthage. Did I put it in here? I should have put that in here. But here's an author, maybe Spanish, who was writing about the Berbers, and he noted that the predominant confederation or tribes kabilas of the Zenata Berbers were the Hawara, Luwata, Nafusa, and the Zaghawa. And of course, the Zaghawa and Nafusa are, you know, many of them are, Zaghawa are almost all black. Nafusa, mostly black. And Luwata is just the older name for these people, Luwata and Hawara, or Hogara. And this actually is an ancient Arabian name too, Hawara. So just like in Ghana, there was a Kelko in Grand Kabylia, or Kabylia. This has nothing to do, this word just means mountain here, but doesn't really, not really to Kabila, meaning tribe. The Zawagha was a region of Kuku in Grand Kabylia as well. That's why you see, where I used to post early paintings of the darker skinned Kabyles, who were the same people. So all these people were called Beribiri, including the Janiwa, who in Ibn Zuri calls Barbaria, the Sonink called El Berabir. But the interesting thing is that they all appear to have been Jewish. Okay, whether you go to Takrur, Kanem, Kanuri, ancient Gal, there's some connection with Judaism, and they're the claim that they come from the Levites, Aaron or Harun and Wakur or Kur, who was a Levite. Or I think he was, wasn't he the son of Aaron or grandson of Aaron? I forget which one. So let's see what else. Yeah, basically, that was what I wanted to show today, that, you know, I'm really sick of people. Now tonight, I forget the, keep forgetting, I'm sorry to forget his name, but the Murakush, Murakush guy that was putting up my Wikipedia article about the Moors, he said that they actually, the people, probably the nationalists in Morocco or something, took down, they were, had it deleted. They said that, you know, it was not accurate in certain ways, that was using older text or something like that. And so apparently the draft was taken down. And I said, well, you know, of course it's going to be taken down because you're not watching, you know, well, I didn't say you're not watching it, but he figured out you can't, you know, put that stuff up and not have it watched because everybody's on the offense against people that don't know their history, like most of us and the Africans, even allowing, not having the resources, I guess, access to the universities make corrections, edit what's being written about them. And that's why I'm glad the Fear of Blackness book is supposed to come out, that is being published by West Africa Review. The one that's already posted on West Africa Review is coming out as a book because it makes some corrections to the misinformation, misconceptions about the origins of the Berbers. And, you know, it shouldn't be only one person that's doing all the correcting. So that's what I'm trying to get everybody to know, you know, all the details, so that nobody can come back and say, you know, this is not right and this is too old or whatever. When you're dealing with ancient sources like the Targums and the, you know, the Arab sources, of course, you can't say those are, that's not what should be used. That's the only way you're going to get some knowledge about, you know, those people, because what was being written was in Arabic. Even by the Africans, they wrote in Arabic. So, you know, it's not, also it's not only other people that should be on the offense. Sometimes it has to be, you know, Black people on the offense. All, you know, all we need to go is go on these Nazi sites, because that's what they are, and say, these people are lying. These are the people that are not producing the right information, that are putting, they're lying about our ancestors. They're saying that the Zaghai weren't in North Africa. The Zaghawa were not in North Africa, spreading to the Sidra, Gulf of Sidra. You know, ever since Gaddafi left, you're not going to have people, you know, much in support of this information. Now, there are certain Arab, there are Arab Moroccans that agree, you know, that this is a bunch of lies being told by Europeans about, you know, where, who the Berbers were. Like I mentioned, this guy in academia, he's a scholar, he's a university professor. What's his name? Ramzi Ruigi or something. He's on my, on the paper, I quoted him, you know, about how he says in the Arabic sources, the Berbers were not indigenous to North Africa. They come anciently from the East. The same thing with the Africans. They claim that they came originally from the East, not from North Africa. So whoever was there in North Africa, it wasn't the Berbers. It wasn't people of Eurasian descent, that's for sure. Whoever, even, like I say, the Arabs said the coast of the Mediterranean were occupied by Ham. Not only that, one place in this book, it says that the peoples in the Eastern Mediterranean were brown in color, brown in Arabic, which is literally the term brown, not tan European, means brown. So, I mean, I hate to be the one, like I said, always the one, only one left on the offense in the Black world. I mean, I don't know what you want, what else. I'm trying to give people information. And if there's stuff, something on Wikipedia that you see, please let me know so I can go and fix it, or, you know, straighten up matters, since obviously nobody else either wants to do it or knows how to do it. Now you do have people, like I said, the Germans, like I said, first when I came on, certain German scholars have said all this, you know, it's a bunch of hooey, what they've been saying about the Africans. A lot of Africans, you know, their traditions show that they did have connection to the Near East. Like this guy that wrote Africa Centered, the something, Ancient Kingdoms of West Africa. You know, that guy, the German guy, Dirk Lang. But mainly it's because of the end of colonialism, and the, actually still not ended, of course, in Palestine and certain other places, where they have made it in an, you know, you can't mention a Black person being north of Sahara unless it's a slave. So that's my feeling. You know, yes. It's not acceptable, but it's being allowed by Africans and, by Africans, because people in charge of the academic in their countries are, of course, not Africans. But I mean, Africans know what's in their, should know what's in their sources and should correct all this misinformation being put out there. So hopefully in the next, you know, couple decades, that will be fixed, because we have a lot of, you know, people, I didn't even know till this year that the Habaniya were also part of the Sudanese Arab groups. They were not just in Yemen, but also in, you know, in the Shua Arab group, in the Shua Arabs, and in living in Darfur or the south of Sudan. So, and if you, the Arabic sources say, and another problem again is the Afrocentric or Pan-African historians who get so afraid when you mention anything about Arabia, thinking that we're talking about modern Arab national people, nationalists. Modern people that speak Arab are not necessarily related to the ancient Khotan people, period. They're not related to the people that Ibn Manzur said were mainly Kudur, or dark brown with kinky hair, or Ibn al-Hakami, the crinkly-haired people, the Copts, crinkly-haired people of the Black Land related to the Arabs. Who is it? Ibn Hakul said that the Beja and the Arabs were the same color, the Beja of Nubia. And that's because the Bisharin, the Beli tribe had come down from Egypt and were working the mines in the eastern desert. So they were there. The Beli and Juhayna, who are tribes of the Kuta Arabs, were the same color as the people in the Hejaz up until like 400 years ago, or even later, because I think it's Burkhart that said that the tribes of Kanuz were descendants of the Rabia Arabs, Rabia. And he was there. He's the one that said that the Eastern people of Eastern Arabia and the Juhayna were indistinguishable, or they looked just alike. So that was only, 300 years ago? Or Burkhart, I think it was about 300 years ago or 200 centuries ago. So a lot of changes have gone on in Arabia. Even Diop said that every educated Arab knows that Arabia was a black colonized area. Now the whoever translated said a Negro colony, but what he meant was that word means black, not in French it meant black. So so I definitely think there's a problem with today's and especially with these people in the Gar who are dark skinned and keep trying to say that they're Afro-Arabs, which is only that has to be qualified. They're not recent Afro-Arabs, although they're related to people biologically in Africa. They found out that especially North Africa and East Africa, they're not descendants of mainly slaves that were brought to Jordan. They're also direct descendants of and have the same tribal names as the people of 10th and 15th century Hejaz and Sinai. The name Kanana is one of the names of the Gar tribes of Jordan, or the Jordan Valley, where there's the Belka, named after Balak, according to the Arab writers, where is the Ma'ain, where is Jericho, and what became known in the Islamic times as Jund Philistine. That's where a lot of them settle in Jund Philistine. And it's also called the Darum, D-A-R-U-M, I don't know how you pronounce it because I'm not good with Arabic yet, which was called a land occupied by Ham. It's the coastal area of Palestine, Balka. It's called Darum. So, and that's what's in this book, my book, The African and Arabian Origins of the Hebrew Bible. I'm trying to explain how Europeans, have consistently gone into these places occupied by the original inhabitants, the indigenous people of Arabia, claiming that they were slaves. When in fact, in the 10th century and before that, these same places are said to be occupied by Black people. Gur-Safi, they found Nabataean ruins there. So both Nabataeans and the Salamians, otherwise known as Minaeans, because the Ma'ain Bin Asur were people of Azd, like the Salim and the Janam and the Lachim, or Beit Lachim, the people of Bethlehem, who only founded Bethlehem in Syria after the time of Christ. So if Christ King was born in Bethlehem, he must have been from the Beit Lachim tribe, because he certainly wasn't born in a place that wasn't there yet. And he was also said to be a Nazarene, and that's also the Nasur are an Arab tribe of the Sulaim, related to the Sulaim. Or I think it was the Sulaim, because there's another important, very, very important work that I think everybody should get. And it's by Michael Lecker. Let's see. Or download. Actually, no, sorry. You can just download it now on Academia. And it's called The Banu Sulaim. And it's a very long discussion of the Sulaim and their tribes. Let's see. Banu Sulaim. The Banu Sulaim, you can download it right now. A Contribution to the Study of Early Islam. Okay. Again, the Michael Lecker, and you know, I'm not trying to be racist or anything, but Israeli writers are so full of themselves, thinking that they are the Israelites and things, and they can't see right before their eyes. This is the tribe of Shalum or Salmai, mentioned in ancient Greek sources as the Salamians, mentioned by Tacitus and Josephus as the people that are likely founders or who Jerusalem was named after. And they're not talking about just the later Jerusalem in Israel, modern Israel, but the earlier Jerusalems, or Jerusalem in near Sana, who's in Jerusalem. These Banu Sulaim were black, and he does a chapter in his book. I don't know if you guess you're not seeing it yet. Or are you? Let me see if I can find it here. Downloads, Sulaim. Why wouldn't I have it here? Here we go. In the last chapter, he claims that, you know, he tries to say that the Banu Sulaim were the only, are you guys looking at Banu Sulaim now or no?
Yeah, it says the Banu Sulaim, a contribution to the study of early Islam.
Okay, yeah, but I just went to my own download, and let's see. I can find it here. Banu Sulaim. So the last portion of his book, it literally says the complexion of the Sulaimis. That's the chapter. And he tries to make it as if the Sulaim were the only black Arabs. Just because, I guess, Al-Jahiz mentions the fact that, the slain tribe of the Hara were black as lava, which some of them still are. But he didn't say that. He said all the tribes of the Hara were black as lava. And as I mentioned, concerning the complexion of the Sulaimis. Okay, here we go. The Sulaimis are singled out for their talents as warriors, especially as horsemen, and for being of a somewhat darker complexion than the members of other tribes. Now, that is only, again, conditionally true because the Kais Elan and Gatafan, I mean, at least in Arabia and Iraq, are, you know, are black. Or the Kais Elan tribes of Beni Amr bin Zaza are among the black people discriminated against in Iraq. Now, they're not exactly pitch black like the crows of the Sulaim, because that's actually what they mean by being a little darker than the other tribes. The Gatafan came directly from the Murad Madij tribe, who are the ones that said there is no such thing. Well, no, that's very rare to see a fair-skinned Arab. Okay, the Gatafan, let's see, Fazar and Abs tribes are in Sudan. The Fazara, I mean, the Abs, of course, were mentioned as black people stamping in the sand with their spears. So I don't know what, you know, why they keep trying to make as if every time they find a black tribe, like that's one of the few. There's no tribe you can't go amongst in the ancient writings and or early writings, medieval writings, and see. And these Sulaim were stretched across their minds were stretched across to Iraq, the Madain Sulaim, the mines of Sulaim, worked by the Bali tribes, the black belly of the Kuta from Hadramaut, and also found in Africa. Okay, as some of the Beja tribes claim to be, are of Bali origin. And the Bali or the Kuta tribe, brethren of the Mara and the Juhana. The Mara tribe that I showed, of course, who are black, even both in Somalia and in the Hadramaut and Oman area, or at least mostly black in those areas in Hadramaut and Oman. So, Kuta and Kais Elan, who are the people that entered Africa, in fact, the Sulaim and Hawazin tribes, Hillel, those are the people that Ibn Mansur said were mostly black or mostly Kuta with kinky hair, because those are the people that crossed into North Africa. So he was familiar with how Arabs looked. So I wish people would stop this nonsense about you know, the Sulaim and certain other tribes being black as if all the other ones weren't the same. And the Kalb tribe, the Salit tribe, the Sawalahian are still in Sinai, in the Torah area of Sinai, and are blackish as Africans. So we know what the Kuta people look like. We know what the Kais Elan looked like, who were the people of Northern Arabia. We know what the Nabataeans looked like because their name meant black, and because other writers, Ibn Nadim, said the Nabataeans were of black complexion. Nabataeans were the people who came from the Kedarines, or literally the tribes of Kedar, otherwise known as Ishmaelites, in the, you know, in the north. So then we're talking about the south. If you go south, you have the Az tribe, and the Az tribe were the ancient, very ancient people that left Marib and moved into Hejaz, moved into other parts of Yemen. Like I said, Yemen, they were called Az Oman. They were called Az Sharat or Sarat after the mountains down there called Sharat. Named after a horse's back. And that's the original Edom, the Sharat of the Bible, the Sharat of the Bible. Anyway, what's interesting is that the I'm pretty sure I saw in here, talking about Jahiz again here. Jehiz is a source of the view that links the color of the environment with the color of its inhabitants. Under Harat bin Sulaim. No, blackness, what? It is one of the wonders because it is black and its inhabitants are all black. No, it said, and all of its inhabitants are black. Stop twisting words. And any non-Sulaimi who settles in it becomes black too, which is bull, because most of the people that settle in there become white because they mixed with other people, especially their white slaves, like it says here. He quotes Jahiz, who claims that the Harat affects originally the white slaves of the Sulaimis and even wild and domesticated animals. The wild and domesticated animals in these places like the Harat apparently are still, for the most part, black, especially in the Najd. A lot of them remain black while the Sulaimis started mixing with the, and the Bali especially started mixing with red people or the white slaves. They're called the red and became very fair in these regions, or the Bali did, especially, according to colonialists. Not in Egypt and Sudan, though, and not in the Yemen. The Bali remained like the Kuta tribes. Now, what's interesting is that, as I said last week, the Kuta are mentioned in, I think, Ptolemy's writings. It was either Ptolemy or Pliny, the ancient first century Greek writers about Arabia. You know, they named all the tribes in Arabia. The Kudat were mentioned next to the Omani tribe in the Yemen, the Hadramaut area. And that KDT is in inscriptions what modern archaeologists translate as Kinda down there. So it is very possible that the Kinda and the Kuta were the same people. The Mara tribe, one of the Mara tribes, according to the colonialists, was a Thawar, and Thawar and Caleb were part of the Kuta. So it's definitely true that were founders of the Kindites. They were the founders of the Kindites. So Kinda, the kingdom of Kinda, and the Kuta people were people from Hadramaut. The Kalb, the Duhana, Mara, Salih or Sheila, Bali, and or Bella as they're called, and Wabara, and other tribes are Kuta tribes. And when Nebuchadnezzar conquered the Yemen, which they try to say he didn't conquer the Yemen, he conquered Levant. According to Arab traditions, these people of Ma'ad were based down next to Madan. The Ma'ad moved to Hijaz, where they were called Madanoi and Madiani by the Greeks. And that's how you get the Kudat north, in the north. You start to get these people, you know, in Hijaz, and they move into Syria with the, become the vassals, minor mining people of the Sulaim. These are the, I forgot to mention one of the more important groups was the Kani or Al-Kain, otherwise called Banu Al-Kain or Baal-Kain, B-A, then apostrophe A-L-Kain, otherwise known as the Kenites. So you have these Kenites came up later to meet with the northern Sulaim, who come from the Az people of Judim, originally in the Yemen. They must have left very early because according to the Greeks, they were, the Sulaimi used to fight against the Greeks, and they were related to the Lud or Al-Oud, like I said, which is also the name of a place in Central Arabia where the people are still dark, cooler in color. Lud was the son of Shem, and according to you know, certain texts, while others say he's the son of Ham. And that is because in the original Arabian tradition, there is no Shem, Ham, and Japhet as three brothers, sons of Noah. So Ham, or the Hamathites, otherwise known as Hameda, are closely connected to the Valley tribe, and they were the people that became known as Ham. They lived in places like the Wadi Hamd in Western Arabia and in the Hameda in the Balka became the Moabites, because Ham and the Ma'in, or Ammonians, Ammonites and Ma'in were actually people related to the Hameda or Ham. But that, as I was saying, has to have been a long time ago that this original Sulaim, the northern Sulaim, lived in south of the Dead Sea, as Josephus mentions them there, but also the Greeks claim to have fought the Salini. They're somehow related to the Minoans, or at least the Greeks thought that the name of Minos came from the Minoans, and also Rodomon, the Rodomon tribe is the Minoan tribe, and that name Rodomanthus very likely originates in that Semitic name, Rodomanthus, son of Minos. So, anyway, I got back to the Arabian portion of, you know, the Arabian tribes related to Ham. But yeah, so this is very interesting in that they say that the mother of, I think it was the mother of Gatafan and the Sulaim was the same woman of Madich. And as I've shown, the tribe of Murad and Madij is still in Yemen. And of course they're black. You know, one of the people that have not, and the Hamdan tribe came from them as well. Is everybody keeping up with what I'm saying? Oh, I don't hear you because.
Okay, you had mentioned the Ammonites and Ham, and I think you mentioned the Moors at the same time.
Yeah, because in the Bible and in the Septuagint, how do you pronounce Septuagint? Is it Septuagint or Gint?
I always was told it was Septuagint.
Oh, okay, Septuagint.
I'm not sure though, but that's what I. Gint? Yeah. Or
Septuagint. It talks about, and the Bible, it talks about the Ma'on or Mehunim as Ham. Children of Ham. Let me see if I can find that one. Page. I had written that in the comment. All right. Oops. Right. So, let me see if I can find where I wrote it. Yeah. Oh, they're, well, in the Septuagint, the term is used for them is Midianites. Simply, the Maonites are referred simply to as Midianites or Ammonites, or else as children of Ham. The Targum uses the word Edomite for the Maonites. The Targums, later Targums, Chronicles 2, replaces the word Maonites with Edomites. And as I mentioned, the Edomites, of course, are still known under the same names in the Yemen and in, you know, spreading to Oman as Jabub or Jobab, Hamumi or Homam, Jishan or Dishane. You know, the sons of Seir or Sayar, as they are known today. And Tamin or Teman, the Temanites. And there's more, there's a couple more very important names of the Edomites besides, oh yeah, Esau, the Esau, which according to Arab, the Arabs there is Esau. So, and those people occupy, some of them occupy both sides of the Red Sea. They're in Africa and they are in Arabia. They are the Arabian Troglodytes originally. So are the tribe of Gaba, became Gabaon or Gabadai, and the name Jebedai, excuse me, Djibouti, is supposed to be, according to one writer that was pointed out to me by Zahi Hawass, related to the name Gaba or Gabaon, who are the biblical Gibeonites. The Gibeonites, Shemeshites, Shemesh, Hamor, and the Kenites are all one people in these Targums and the Bible. So these are all South Arabian peoples. Actually, in inscriptions, they're called, the Musnad inscriptions are called Sukhema tribe. The Sheshemites are called Sukhema. And they are found in the area where the Queen of Sheba is called Bilkis, where her town was, which I forget the name of, Bilkis. But anyway, inscriptions were found there in the Yemen. So Ma'in was also, they were located in the Barakish area, which is ancient Yatil, in the South Yemen between Saba and Hadramaut, in the area called the Jalf. And its name, capital was Karnal. So these are just notes I was writing, I was recently writing about how there's a local tradition in that area of Ma'in, otherwise called Gar Safi, or near Gar Safi, that Ma'in was the son of Lot. Of course, this is Ma'on of the Bible. And Ma'in was, in Arabic tradition, descended from Azd, the Azd people, just like the Lachim or Lahim and Jadam and the Sulaim. The original southern Sulaim come from that area. Just like the Bahila come from the Ma'an bin Asur as well, otherwise known as Bilha. So just have to remember who the biblical peoples are and you put two and two together. But you have to know something about the language. You have to know something about the history of the people. You can't just say, oh, this sounds like such and such, so this must be. For example, Ibn al-Kalbi of the Kalb tribe of Kuta wrote that it was named after, that Amman was named after Oman bin Siba bin Yaqtan, which is Jaqtan probably, bin Ibrahim, who built the city of Oman, which is otherwise called Amman today. But Sheikh al-Rabwa, which is, I forget the name of him, that's al-Damashqi, he makes the name Oman bin Lut, that is Amman bin Lut. So Amman and Ma'an are towns closely. Amman is not far from Ma'in in Jordan today. So those are the places they went. They went to the south in Yemen and they went to the north. I don't know if you're looking at the same thing I am now, but Yeah, so they were supposed to be from the Azd Oman. They're called Oman bin Lut. They were next to the Kudat, even in the Yemen, according to ancient Greek geographers. Here we have the Balkha region of the Gur, or Jordan Valley, is also, according to some encyclopedias, the land of Ammon, or the Ammonites. And remember I said, in South Arabia, there was inscriptions showing that Ammon was a clan of the Gabaon people. The Gabaon were a people of the Minaeans, or the, I don't know if it was vice versa or what. I think it's the Gabaon. No, yeah, the Gabaon were people of the Minaeans, or the Mayin, who worshipped a deity named Gaba. Gaba, by the way. So you'll see the people called Gabaon down there, and they are the people called Gibeonites, closely connected to the Benjamin tribe, or Beni Yamin, even down there in Yemen. And the Beni Yamin are the people closely related to the Beni On, or Yafi bin Kasid, who I showed you, still exist in the Yemen and in the Yafi Yahar and in Africa. Banu Yamina was a medieval, they often wrote the name Banu Yam, which is a tribe in ancient times, in medieval times, and in now in the Yemen.
I got something here. I don't want a question about it. Right here where you're at is right there here where is it? Now this is under Al-Yakubi of Tariq. Okay, right below that they were talking about they were talking about something about Kabil, which was
I think Kabil is Abel.
Yeah.
Hobo, or one of those, Hobo.
Okay, now, the sentence after that, it says, he made musical instruments, songs, flutes.
Drums.
Okay, now those are, those were frowned upon back then.
Oh, yeah. Well, still, okay. Still in some Islamic, because these people were, Yakubi wasn't Muslim. So the Muslims, some Muslims do not like you.
Right.
Music. It's just considered, yeah.
So this is suggesting that in Noah's time, they had a religion. Is that correct?
No.
No.
They're just saying that the people of Ham, black people, they used to like to play music instruments, songs, sing songs. They were the people that first did that. That's all. Canaanites were the ones that first did that. Now, okay. Now you have to understand, Cain, like I said, was, it actually Canaan, Cain-en, kind of connected to the word Canaan. That's why, the Kenites and all those people, those are the people that made all these things too.
Okay.
Kenites, Jubal, and, so they're just, he's Armenian and he doesn't really know, much about the Arabs per se and the ancient Yemenites. He's just writing about the fact that black people were, they're good, even in his time, they're good at singing, they're good at, drumming and making music and having fun. So basically these people, like I said, the people like the Parthians and the other Persian, Afghanistan, Tajikistan and all these other places that really had nothing to do with Arabs or Islam originally. Okay. They are the ones that are saying these people are cursed. The Cain and Canaan and black people are descendants of those people. Because they knew that the Al-Tain, the mining people of Northern Arabia, were the Kenites. And the Kanana tribe too were, they're black, and they still are in some places, as are the Quraysh, who come from the Kanana. Now, the Croatian Sinai and other places in Palestine are black. They're called actually, though, Garasha or Gararsa. And I was given a picture of them, the ones in Sinai, by the, I don't know if you're from New York or no, I've been to New York, the Caribbean Cultural Center. There was a man working there named Daniel, Danny Dawson, I think his name was. And he had a friend who was from India, a young student, I think graduate student that was working in Sinai as a, you know, I don't know if she was doing archaeology or anthropology, whatever. She went there and she brought back, because I asked him after he told me that the Croatian Sinai were black. I told him, well, I'll believe that when I see it. And he brought back pictures of them. And they're just regular black people. Or they were, you know, that when she brought this picture back. And I said, wow. So, and they actually complain about being too black. So, you know, just fascinating. And those are the people of Kanana. And the Kanana also live in the Gar or Jordan Valley, along with other, you know, other very ancient, the Hamada and the, you know, the children of Lut, whatever, the people, these people all came from by way of Sinai and the Hejaz to the Levant at various times from further south in the Yemen. So the Kalb tribe or Kaleb, the Salih tribe or Shila, the Mara have a tribe called the Marer among them, and then the Mareri in the Bible. I don't know who the Kuda could have been, but they're definitely, that's what those people are considered, from Kuda, who lived in Hadramaut at one time. And like I said, it was before Nebuchadnezzar conquered that area. This is the Kindite area from Hadramaut to Central Arabia. Kindite kingdom, you know, as early as the 4th century BC existed there. Yeah, look, Al-Masudi said claimed the five cities of Lot were in the Jannah Philistine and that they called their kings Bari, as mentioned in the Pentateuch. So yeah, I did look it up in Moab. One of the kings, at least one of the kings is mentioned as Bari or Beria or something like that. And so in the this area of Jannah Philistine, you have the Sodom or Sodom, Belka, Beit Shean, or Besan, Zoar, and Gomorrah. But like I said, these are names that are also found farther south in the Yemen and some in the Assyria area, because that's where people, you know, when they left as Minaeans, they brought this knowledge, or excuse me, not the knowledge, these names with them into Assyria and then into the Levant. Now here, see, it says, showing you that the valley lived, you have tribes called Muakile, or they're also called Makil, the Arad, and the Boot, who dwell in and near Wadi Farah, which is near Sinai, or in Sinai, and that they escort the Syrian pilgrims. The escort of the Syrian pilgrims is continued by the Muwahibs, the principal clan of the Banu Beli. Now this name I had once thought was Moab, but it's not. It's actually Mawahib is not related. I was thinking of something else, Muawiyah, not Muwahib. Yeah, but still it shows you that Banu Lut is still, you know, those are the people there. And the Makil were a tribe of the Bali who came in with the Sulaim, because these are vassal tribes of the Sulaim. And the Farim bin Bali also, as Arabs came in, Farah, Wadi Farah is named for them. Bera, the Arab tribe of Bera, and the ancient Amalekite tribe of Faraim. But the Faraim, or we call Faraim bin Bali, however, original ones, the Faraim clan of the Bali was Amalekite. So the Mu'akil or Makil Arabs, like I said, were the ancestors of the Sulaim tribes, Charza Arab people, who invaded, who are shown in the that Aragon picture. The king of Aragon has captives of the, you know, Moorish captives. It says Moro. And that has to be, I think that was the 14th century or 13th century, when the, you know, the king of Aragon conquered the Moors. The Shi'ala or Saleh or Banu Saleh were a well-known tribe of the Yemen that remained in the Yemen. The Kalb were a well-known tribe of the Kuta. I don't know if they remained there in the Yemen, but the Mara, of course, remained in the Yemen, also found in Africa as one of the tribes of the Somali or Bin Sumal. Okay, so this is basically, I've already gone through that. Also, okay, the Rufeda, Rephidim, the Udra, Ezra, Zayn Alat, El Haf was Epha, I know that. Sud, Jaina, or Chaina was supposed to be from Juhaina, one of the Bali, the ancient Bali, not the later Arab Bali that came across. So that name, Juhaina, is supposed to be related to Chaina, as well as the, in the, like I said, the Book of Yashar, there's Janaeus. So the Edomite, because the Edomites, Moabites, all these tribes were very closely related groups or clans of people from the Sabian Menaean people. So archaeologically, they're called Sabian Menaean people. They were speakers of the Sahadic dialects, or the remnant speak, non-Arabized people still speak the Sahadic dialect, and they used to write in a dialect which archaeologists now call the Musnad, and the Thamudic, because the Thamud people also came from the Ad of Hadramaut in the Yemen. And the Thamud are the people who, like I said, the Greeks called them Nabataeans and Thamud were the same people. The Nabate of the Aus or Uz were the same people. How do we know that? Because they're mentioned in ancient inscriptions in the Jordan area with the Sulaimi. And it literally says, talks about contract between the Sulaimi and the Nabate. Later on in Muhammad's time, the Nabate were still asking Muhammad, PBUH, if they could maintain their hereditary tie or contract with the Sulaim people, who were the Salamians of Greek raiders. Of, you know, the inscriptions, it says Salaim. And there's a place of the Nabataeans called Salaim, in fact. So we know that the Sulaim of later date, or Sulaim bin Mansur, and then were people in contract or an alliance, because that's what they had in pre-Islamic times. They had different kind of alliances where you had to do certain things. You had to go protect your allied tribe, even up until medieval times and colonial times, they were doing that. But Muhammad said, no, you cannot keep this tie with the Sulaim. So that's how we know that the Nabateans are the Nabate tribe of the Aus, the giant Aus Ansar of the Khazraj, while the Salaim were the same people as the Salamian people south of the Dead Sea, who Josephus mentions as being the people thought that they were founders of Jerusalem. Also, Tacitus said that it's thought that they were Assyrians and Ethiopians, or that they had come from Ethiopia, as well as being Jews, because they were, like I said, they were the same people as the, in fact, they were the Jews. They were the people called Shalma. They were the people called Kenites, or the vassals were called Kenites. They lived among them, or the Kenites lived among them in Northern Arabia, just as in South Arabia. And I wanted to mention something about that. Yeah, Shalma and, oh, so today's Sulaim are found among the Harb, the Banu Sulaim, as well as Hawazin Mansur. Their clans, mentioned in medieval times, are found among the Harb, as well as the Hawatate or Huwaitat people. The same clans mentioned in the Bible are found among these people, as well as some of the Nabatean people mentioned in the Nabatean inscriptions among the Hawatate. And the Hawatate are one of the, you know, the darker skinned people that they thought came from Egypt because they were so dark, and thought they were, you know, somehow African related. But no, they're just remnants of the original Nabatean and Sulaim people who, you know, they're mixed with fair skinned people, but they were dark enough to be considered, like I said, African by some of the colonialists. Many of them are still dark skinned. Many of the Hawaitate people lived south of the Dead Sea, or in the Gur, where, you know, the people were black. The word Guarani means valley blacks, or signifies valley blacks. It doesn't mean it, but that's what it signifies, valley black, a black of the valley. Jordan Valley, Black Valley. Or many, you know, whatever part of the Jordan Valley is the Gore, that's where the word Guarani is applied to, among to the blacks of the Jordan Valley. And as I said, Jericho was one of the places, as well as Zoar, and the Gore Safi and Gore Mazra. And it's Richard Burton, I think, that mentions the Salamean Hawatate or Huatate south of the Dead Sea. So all these people that Tacitus talked about and Joseph has talked about are still there, and that the Targums talked about, black, and said were Sheshemites and Kenites, and of, you know, of the race of the Hamathites and Rechabites, who were the people that worshiped Yahweh. So they were the Jews. Yes, they were the Jews. But these Jews, and the Helikites too, the Helikites are there as a Halik or Elegat, they live in Sinai, they live in Jordan, they live in Africa, even in Sudan. So all these biblical peoples of Judah are still there, okay? But these biblical peoples of Judah are also the same people as were the Mansur or Manasseh from Israel, who came originally from the south. Manasseh and Machir, his son Machir, are in the south and in Somalia. Machir and Galadi or Gilead are in Somalia, as well as Southern Arabia. Okay, well, oh, it's only, I feel like I talked longer than last, the last session, but it's only 10. I think I started around 7:30. No, 7. Yeah, 7:30, I think I started. No, but anyway, okay, well, any questions?
I think I got all mine in. I'm going to have to just sit down and do some studying. That's about it. I'm understanding it now a lot more.
Time for a quiz. Time for a quiz, Tyvon.
Yeah, I missed the first half of the what you're talking about.
I went over much of it again, but
okay, that's nice. I'll be able to compare and contrast when I go over the video. Okay.
Yeah, you can watch the first part of it. And actually, I was just talking a lot about the Zaghawa or Zaghai and how people try to, you know, ignore the fact that they were Songhai and that they were also the original inhabitants of Carthage, Zeugitania. Regio Zeugis was the area of Carthage. And south of that, later on, it's called Zeugitania or Zeugitania.
Yeah, that was fascinating. I never knew about the Songhai being in, or Zaghawa being in Carthage.
Well, you know, we're talking about centuries before medieval period, of course, but just like the Franks, or just like the Celts had connection to, you know, Eurasia.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not that, you know, it's just like that. The Arabs had had tribes in Tabaristan, really. So people, you know, people move, and that's the problem, is that they tried to make the Africans into some black, teeming black race, as Diop puts it, teeming black race south of the Sahara that never moved anywhere, never did anything, only ate people. And, you know, that's why you have some Nazi Moroccans in the northernmost coast, not all of them, but not even most of them, but there's a group of Moroccans, nationalist Europheals, who are starting to claim that they are the ones that built all these magnificent cities, or Berber places of the Zaghai, Songhai, Genoa, in the Sudan, because they think of themselves as the Berbers of the ancient world, when in fact they were not the Berbers. I mean, it looks like, according to the genetics, that they're descendants of Slavic peoples who either came in as slaves or as, you know, people that were joined the North Africans as renegade, you know, and turned Muslims, turned Turk, turned Muslim. So, and all I should mention before I go, what Ibn Tumart said about how the Masmuda, remember how, and this is before Abu Shama spoke of them as being black skinned. Ibn Tumart said that in his area, the Masmuda were turning. The children were turning fair while the fathers were still dark. The children had light eyes and were turning fair because the European Christians being brought in, or being sent into Africa to collect taxes and taking advantage of the Masmuda women. So that's how it started. That's how you start changing people. Just like in our country, you had, you know, people, the European taking advantage of the African women, and you get lighter skinned African types. But I'm not going to go around saying my African ancestors were fair just because, you know, my mother or something was fair. My European ancestors were not fair, not black. Just because I'm dark doesn't mean they were dark. I mean, that's common sense, but you don't have that in a lot of places because people are not, you know, they're not taught in school. They don't go to school, some of them, so they don't have sense that we should have. Just like in this country, you have a bunch of barbarians running around claiming, you know, Trump is Jesus Christ. So I had to throw that in.
I think I have one question about the Songhai Zaghai, Zaghawa people. If they have involvement in Carthage, do you know of any sources talking about them potentially being amongst the Barcid people that went to Spain?
Amongst the what
that went to Spain? The Barcid people that established like Hannibal's father and his family, like the Barcid people. You know, like the Barcid established.
I don't know. All I know is that Carthage was inhabited by Negroid types and Tuareg types.
Okay.
the so-called long-headed Mediterranean type, but I do know that the word Afar or Afrin actually is more connected to Tuareg. But Barca, Hannibal Barca, he's called. He's called an Afar. That might be because he's from Afarik, which is the name of ancient Tunisia, or northern Tunisia. But he's called Hannibal Barca, which is connected to the Daju or Gorain people. So could have been either. Now, the coins show him, there are certain ancient coins, of course, that show him more Negroid, not Afarik looking. So, but I don't know which one, because they're both very warlike people. Those people were all, that's how they got to be head of the Sudan. The Songhai got to be head of Sudan. Look at the Kisei or whatever his name was, Kisei. The Susu and Kusei, they were very warlike people originally. And but the Tuareg, of course, were much taller, bigger people. So I don't know how that worked out. All I know is that the Tuareg and the Songhai and the Soning were all often together as known as Sanhaja and Zanada. Those groups were usually together, mentioned together, just like in Arabia. You had the Kenites and the Malachites.
Yeah, lots of tribal confederacies and whatnot.
I said
a lot of tribal confederacies.
Yeah. But, you know, they're all still living together.
They've
still lived together in the North African area for thousands, 3,000 years.
So do you know if the Banu Ifran and the Zaghawa Songhai people, et cetera, were counted amongst the Carthaginian Jews?
There were Jews in Carthage?
Yeah, I've seen some sources about it.
Actually, what I'm saying is, if the Zaghawa and Ifrane were Jewish, they have to have been, I don't know about Jewish, I know Israelite.
Okay.
Israelite, okay. I don't know about Jewish, but I know that probably the guy might have been Jewish, like I said, Levite, but the Tuareg were definitely, Ephraim were definitely not, they were definitely Amalekite, who gone before Judaism, or before, yeah. They were the people that originally chased out the Canaanite people that were probably Jewish, like the guy. So I personally think that the Tuareg were Judaized by the Zaghai people or the Songhai Sonic people.
Okay, interesting.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
The Ephraim, like I said, look at that. If you can get that JSTOR, I'll try to download that, but I don't think you can. The JSTOR article, the problem of the Judaized Berbers, where since Ephraim were basically the same thing as the Ephraim tribe of Israel. Now, that doesn't mean that they were Jewish, because they were not Judean, they were Israelites. There were many Israelites.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. But there were, like I said, the Bakara or Wakara, and Wakur and Wa'n'Gara, who were the Sonic and Songhai people. Now, they were always described before a certain period. It seems like they were always described as Jewish. And they're the ones that in the Tariq al-Fatah, and I think also the first Sudan mentioned them being descendants of Teres and Arun, Harun, and Wakur, you know, for the Levite people. So, but I think the Tuareg personally came over, were people that came in later, had remained in Yemen, but came in later. When I say later, though, I'm talking about only like several hundred years later. Because they say they left the Yemen, or Canaan, 900 years before Alexander the Great, which is 380, or so they came in later. There were the camel-owning people that brought the camel into, and the Tifinagh also might have come in with them.
Well, thank you very much for that, sister. I got to jump off right now.
Oh.
but I will definitely be, I'm going to get in contact with you on Facebook about trying to set up some interviews during Black History Month, if you have the time during Black History Month.
Hopefully, definitely. Because, I mean, I'm busy with school, but other than that.
Okay.
Hopefully I recorded this too. I'm trying to remember.
Yeah, it's recording. I can see it right now.
Oh, that's right.
Okay. It gave me the it's recording warning when I came in.
I remember when you turned it on, I heard it.
Turned off.
All right.
I don't know if I'll be able to.